when I got back in 84, I then went back and did my degree. And then in 1988, I bought the water tower. And I spent the next 7 years literally building the water tower. And during that time, I didn't travel. I think I went to Kenya. I traveled bits in Africa, but not on a motorbike. It was all in cars, or I hired vehicles, or I was on buses or whatever. And then in the early 90s, probably the early 90s, I started to travel again because the water tower was sort of finished. And then I went to Australia. Well, my son was born in 1990. And then when he was 4 years old, I went to Australia and I got my pilot's license in 91, and then I went to Australia with Tom when he was about four, and I hired a plane in Sydney, and then we flew all around from Sydney up the East Coast and then into Esrock and back down to Sydney, and then I dumped the plane in Sydney, and then I got a camper van, I bought a camper van, an old Volkswagen camper van, and I drove 4 months all around Australia with Tom. It was interesting flying. It was interesting traveling on with a plane, because you saw a whole different side. You know, your life was kind of like little airports and like airstrips in the middle of nowhere, and you'd be camping under the wing, and so that was completely different to being on a motorbike. And then when we were in the camper van, again, that was a different way of traveling. So it's all kind of just different ways of doing it, really. And then I got back from that, and then I went to Africa. I did South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, and Zimbabwe for 4 or 5 months. Then I did a trip I flew out to Kathmandu. Oh, no, that's right. In 88, I flew out to Kathmandu, and I walked over the Himalayas into Tibet, and I spent 4 months traveling around Tibet on foot. But then in 95 or 96, I flew out to Kathmandu again, and I hired an Enfield bullet, and I rode that over the Himalayas into Tibet and went to Lhasa, and then I rode back again, so that was pretty good. And then I went to South America. I did Peru, Bolivia, Chile, and Argentina. I did Peru on a bike and the rest of it. So it was all a kind of mishmash of different things depending on where I could get bikes. And then in 2003, Nick Sanders asked me to be a tour manager for his World Challenge, and so I basically went around the world again with 23 motorcyclists for 3 months. So we did 33,000 miles, and then I did 4 or 5 trips with him across from New York to Alaska to Mexico back to New York. I did 7 or 8 trips with him to Morocco. About a year ago, I was invited to join this all-women's tour to Pakistan. Lisa, who she runs a podcast in San Francisco called Misfits or Motorcyclists and Misfits. And so she did a podcast. So she interviewed me because one of the people on the radio had found me on the internet or something, and they were convinced I was really badass. So she's really badass. Anyway, so they emailed me and said, would I be up to do an interview, which I did. And then it was about 6 months after that, Liza phoned me or emailed me and said, would I be interested, because she was getting this all-woman's bike tour together to ride through all the mountains of northern Pakistan. And it was a sort of, the trip was also to visit schools and to basically inspire and help Pakistani women, to encourage them to realise that they can do, they have choices in life. And we had Honda 150s, but actually they were fine. They were perfect for the roads. And it was brilliant. Most of the group were from America, and there was myself and Anita, who was from Holland. And we had a fantastic time, and we helped Pakistani women learn to ride motorbikes and just inspired them, really. Met these incredible, girls that were sort of 14, 15, 16, who wanted to become doctors and lawyers and were really studying hard and educate. The key thing is education in these countries. And a lot of these countries countries, women still don't have the opportunities to get educated. It's really the thing that has to change. But there are little, you know, these little pockets of, you know, there are schools which have been set up by women, and there were factories that we visited that have been that just employ women, and so, you know, there are these little just starting to help women who want to work and want a different life. I think the whole motorcycling part of it was that, you know, motorcycling to most of us represents freedom, and that's the way they sort of see motorcycling as well, that it gives them the freedom. And because motorbikes are relatively, compared to cars, relatively inexpensive, it's a sort of form of transport that they have got some chance of actually, you know, being able to get, and to give them the freedom to, you know, to go out and to do things. So I think it's that sort of element of it. And I think because they see the whole thing of riding motorbikes as this thing that will set them free and give them the, and I think it's probably more in their minds than actually the reality in some ways. But that's kind of what it's, that's the main, you know, that's a very important part, really.